Good evening, everyone. My name is Tyler Harms with the Iowa Department of Natural Resources. Thank you for attending our virtual public meeting about chronic wasting disease this evening. We'll get started in just a couple minutes, but before we do, I just wanted to provide a few things for you. First of all, if you have questions throughout the presentation this evening, you can type them in the Q&A block, which should be appearing at the bottom of your screen. We'll try to answer those questions either by typing answers into that block, or we may answer questions at the end of the presentation this evening. If you do notice a question in the Q&A block that you would also like to ask, rather than typing it in again, you can upvote that question by just selecting the question and hitting the thumbs up button. And that's a way that you can indicate to us that that's also a question that you would like addressed this evening. One other thing to mention is that if you are experiencing technical difficulties, if you can't see the presentation, or perhaps you can't hear me speaking, you are welcome to raise your hand. And we have some staff that will be able to hopefully troubleshoot with you during the presentation. However, I will also mention that this presentation is being recorded and will be shared on our website probably sometime in the next week or so once we get everything processed. So again, my name is Tyler Harms. I'm with the Iowa Department of Natural Resources, and thanks very much for attending our virtual public meeting this evening. Our goal for this meeting is to introduce you to chronic wasting disease and its history in Iowa, and talk just a little bit about what the Department of Natural Resources is doing to manage this disease in Iowa, and how you, as a hunter or a citizen of Iowa, or perhaps a passionate conservationist, can help us slow the spread of this disease. So first, let's talk a little bit about what chronic wasting disease is. A chronic wasting disease is defined as a slowly progressive, uniformly fatal brain disease of cervids. Now, uniformly fatal is really important. That means that this disease is 100% fatal. If a deer becomes infected with chronic wasting disease, it will ultimately succumb to the effects of that disease. Again, this is a disease that affects cervids. So in Iowa, that's white-tailed deer, but it does also affect mule deer, elk, reindeer, and moose in other states and countries. Chronic wasting disease belongs to a group of diseases known as transmissible spongiform encephalopathies, or TSEs. These types of diseases include scrapie in sheep, bovine spongiform encephalopathy, or mad cow disease, one that many of you may have heard of, and also Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease in humans. TSEs are spread by a misfolded host protein called a prion. And that's another important distinction of chronic wasting disease. It is not caused by a virus, a fungus, or a bacterium. These prions are proteins that normally occur in our body when a deer becomes infected or comes in contact with an infected animal. The prions in our body misfold, they accumulate, and that's what causes infection in deer. And so that's, again, a really important distinction about chronic wasting disease and how it's different from other diseases that affect deer in Iowa. Chronic wasting disease is spread primarily via deer-to-deer contact or direct contact. It can be spread through bodily fluids like mucus, saliva, or urine, but it can also be spread indirectly through the environment. So if a deer becomes in contact with a contaminated surface, like contaminated soil or scrapes or feeding areas, a deer can also become infected with chronic wasting disease via that transmission route. Chronic wasting disease, as I mentioned before, is a very slowly progressive disease. And what that means is that after a deer becomes exposed to the disease, it takes an average of 18 to 36 months from that initial exposure for the deer to start showing clinical signs of the disease. So in other words, a deer might look perfectly healthy for 18 to 36 months after it has become infected with chronic wasting disease, but during that time, it is still infectious. So it can still shed the disease and shed the infectious prions in saliva by up to 3 months after exposure and in urine up to 6 months after exposure. Prions accumulate in all tissues in the deer. This includes muscle tissue, antler, velvet, and skin, and they are highly resistant to deactivation and can persist in the environment, meaning they're very hard to remove from a surface or from the environment once they've been introduced. Here we list some clinical signs of chronic wasting disease. These include progressive weight loss, increased drinking and urination, excessive salivation, behavioral changes, decreased social interaction. So they're acting or they are alone and not interacting with other deer. Loss of awareness and loss of fear of humans. Again, I want to remind you that a deer can be infectious during that preclinical stage, those 18 to 36 months after initial exposure, before it starts showing these clinical signs. And so one thing that we always want to make sure folks understand is that it's really hard to diagnose chronic wasting disease on the hoof. First, because, as I mentioned before, a deer can look perfectly healthy but still be infected with chronic wasting disease. But also, you might notice that many of those clinical signs that we were listed on the previous slide are also signs that a deer may exhibit that's sick with a variety of other diseases that are more common among white-tailed deer in Iowa. Most deer that have tested positive in Iowa for chronic wasting disease have appeared healthy. They've been behaving normally and appear in good body condition. In fact, the deer that you see pictured here on the slide was one that was harvested in South Central Iowa. And that deer did test positive for chronic wasting disease. Although I think all of us might agree that this deer looks perfectly healthy and in good body condition. And so what's important about this is that testing for chronic wasting disease is really key, especially when you're hunting in an area where the disease has been previously detected. Testing for chronic wasting disease is also important for you as a hunter in order to make informed consumption decisions. The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, or CDC, recommends testing deer harvested in areas known to have CWD. And if that deer does test positive, they recommend discarding the meat from CWD positive animals. And so this is also the guidance that we provide to our hunters in the field. So I'm sure many of you have probably heard some about hemorrhagic disease. This past year, we've had a pretty significant outbreak of hemorrhagic disease in Iowa. And I wanted to take just a minute or two here and talk about the differences between hemorrhagic disease and chronic wasting disease, because these two diseases are often confused. And here on the slide, you'll see that we have some of those factors that make these diseases very different. First and foremost, as I mentioned before, chronic wasting disease is caused by a misfolded host protein or a prion, yet hemorrhagic disease is actually caused by a virus. So that's a very key distinction between these two diseases. Hemorrhagic disease is spread by a biting insect, whereas chronic wasting disease is, again, spread by direct and indirect contact. Adult bucks have the highest risk of being infected with chronic wasting disease, whereas in hemorrhagic disease, the disease is non-discriminatory, meaning it's going to affect bucks, does, yearlings, adults, the same across the board. Some deer survive infection with hemorrhagic disease, and actually we expect to see more deer survive infection as our population becomes less naive to this disease as we experience more outbreaks of this disease. But again, chronic wasting disease is always fatal. So if a deer becomes infected with chronic wasting disease, it will 100% of the time ultimately succumb to the effects of that disease. As I mentioned before, chronic wasting disease, that infectious prion can persist in the environment for many years, whereas hemorrhagic disease, that virus can't survive in the environment. And because it's spread by a biting insect, often that disease cycle is ended when we experience the first frost in fall and winter. Hemorrhagic disease outbreaks are often sporadic, and they don't occur every year, as I'm sure many of us are aware. However, chronic wasting disease is both spreading in its geographic footprint and also increasing in prevalence. In other words, chronic wasting disease is here. It's continuing to spread in Iowa and is showing no signs of going away anytime soon. We also know that populations can recover from hemorrhagic disease, and we've seen this happen after significant outbreaks that we've experienced in Iowa in the past. Whereas there's a lot of research that shows that there are long-term population impacts of chronic wasting disease. So again, these diseases are very different, and I wanted to just take a couple minutes here to talk a little bit about how they are different and help everyone understand that, so that we can help spread the word about the differences in these diseases to our friends, our family members. Okay, so let's talk now just a little bit about the history of chronic wasting disease in Iowa. So as of today, we've detected chronic wasting disease in 263 wild deer across Iowa since it was first detected in 2013 in Allamaquis County up here in the northeast corner of the state. Since then, we've detected chronic wasting disease in 15 additional counties in Iowa. So after Allamaquis, we detected it in Clayton County in 2016. Then in 2017 in Wayne County in South Central Iowa, 2018 in Dubuque County, 2019 in Winneshiek and Fayette Counties in Northeast Iowa, Decatur County in South Central Iowa, and then also Woodbury County in Western Iowa, 2020 in Appanoose County in South Central Iowa and Jackson County in Eastern Iowa, 2021 in Greene County in Central Iowa, and then also Fremont County in Southwest Iowa, 2022 in Lucas County in South Central, Jasper County in Central, and then Grundy County in North Central Iowa. And then just this past summer in 2023, we detected chronic wasting disease in Marshall County in Central Iowa. It's important to know, however, that chronic wasting disease is not an issue that's unique to Iowa. As of November of this year, chronic wasting disease has been detected in 31 states in the United States, and also 4 Canadian provinces and other countries as well. And so this is an issue that's not unique to Iowa, and that many states in the U.S. Are experiencing. And so, again, this disease is continuing to expand its geographic footprint in North America and elsewhere. So I talked a little bit about the importance of testing for chronic wasting disease earlier, because it's important for hunters to make informed consumption decisions. But testing is also a way in which we can monitor the spread and prevalence of this disease in Iowa. And we do this through a statewide surveillance program. We started testing for chronic wasting disease in 2002. And we did this because early detection is key for effective management. The earlier that we can detect chronic wasting disease in an area, the better chance we have to getting in there and slowing the spread of the disease as fast as possible. Our statewide surveillance program includes a multifaceted approach. We have a risk-based surveillance approach that's designed to detect the disease in new areas as early as possible. We also have a prevalence monitoring approach that we use in areas where we have previously detected chronic wasting disease so that we can monitor the effects of our management practices. So prevalence is the proportion of animals that are infected in the population. And so that's a really good metric to monitor for disease tracking and for evaluating the effectiveness of management actions. Our statewide surveillance program samples about 6,000 deer per year, again, across the state. Primarily these samples are from hunter harvested deer. And I'll talk a bit later about how hunters can partner with us in this really important effort. We also collect samples from roadkill animals and then animals that that appear sick or are acting abnormally in areas where we have chronic wasting disease will often respond and determine the best course of action for those animals. And sometimes we do need to dispatch those animals and we test those for chronic wasting disease as well. So as I mentioned, we conduct statewide surveillance, which means that we collect samples in every county of the state. And you'll see here some numbers and different shadings on this map. And I wouldn't worry too much about understanding the numbers, but the shadings are really important. The lighter shaded areas that you see are what we consider our lower priority areas where we're still collecting samples in those areas, but they're a fairly low priority because they're not adjacent to any areas where we have chronic wasting disease. The darker shading that you see on the map are higher priority areas, and it increases up to these bright red areas that you see, say, in northeast and eastern Iowa and also in south central Iowa. Those are all areas where we previously detected chronic wasting disease and where we're implementing that prevalence monitoring strategy that I mentioned before. The kind of darker red areas or the maroon areas that you see on the map, those are also areas where we've detected chronic wasting disease in the wild, but we're still in that risk-based monitoring phase where we're trying to detect the disease in new areas and just get a better understanding of what we're dealing with in those areas. So if you're on the meeting tonight and you hunt in any of these darker shaded areas, I strongly encourage you to consider contacting your local wildlife biologist to submit samples from harvested deer that you may harvest in the upcoming shotgun seasons or during the muzzleloader seasons. And we'll talk again a little bit later about what testing looks like and how you can contribute. This is a map of all of the samples that we've collected since we started in 2002. It's totaled just more than 100,000 samples that we've collected across the state since 2002. So we've been monitoring this disease for almost 21 years now. Again, first detected in 2013, and we continue to monitor it across the state to this day. So let's talk now a little bit about what happens when we detect chronic wasting disease in a new area in Iowa. Well, first and foremost, as I've already mentioned a couple of times tonight, sampling and testing is really important because it helps us understand what we're dealing with in terms of disease on the landscape in an area. So the first thing that we do when we detect chronic wasting disease in a new area is that we implement an increased sampling effort for 3 to 5 years following that initial detection. Our goal is to collect 750 sampling points. Now, you might be wondering what sampling points are. Sampling points are what we use in that risk-based surveillance strategy to help us get the most informative samples on the landscape. So I mentioned earlier when talking about the differences between hemorrhagic disease and chronic wasting disease that adult bucks have the highest risk of being infected with chronic wasting disease. Now, if we think about the behavior of adult bucks and how chronic wasting disease is spread, that makes perfect sense. Chronic wasting disease is spread primarily via direct contact, and we know that adult bucks have been on the landscape for longer, and they're frequently interacting with a number of different deer and different deer family groups, particularly this time of year during the rut. And so it makes sense then that demographic class would have the highest risk for becoming infected with chronic wasting disease. Because of that, then, those samples from adult bucks are what provide us the best information for our surveillance program. And so those adult buck samples get the highest number of points. The lowest risk class that we sample are yearling females or yearling does. They haven't been on the landscape very long. oftentimes they have a restricted home range and they're not interacting with a number of other animals. And so they have a lower risk of being infected with chronic wasting disease. And so they're the fewest number of points in our surveillance program. And so that's how we utilize that risk-based surveillance and those sampling points to try to get the best bang for our buck, so to speak, when it comes to collecting samples on the landscape. Now, as we implement that increased sampling strategy, if we get additional detections in that area, then we establish what's called a disease management zone, where we maintain sampling to estimate prevalence, but we also may adjust harvest goals locally that results in increased harvest opportunity for our hunters, but also results in increased chance of removing disease animals from the landscape, and also some density reduction in order to slow the spread of the disease as much as possible. We know based on results from a number of different studies and also what other states are experiencing that have had chronic wasting disease for much longer, that density reduction is the best way to slow the spread of the disease, our best management tool in essence. If we don't get any additional detections of chronic wasting disease during that 3 to 5 year increased sampling window after that initial detection, then we would simply go back to routine surveillance. In other words, that county would just go back to whatever priority level it was before, with perhaps a bit of an elevated priority because of that previous chronic wasting disease detection. Our ultimate goal when managing populations to slow the spread of chronic wasting disease is to maintain that population at low goal level, or the low end of our population goal, because we know that will help us slow the spread of the disease, but we also know that low end of the population goal will still offer a quality recreational experience for our hunters. So I mentioned before establishment of a disease management zone. This is just an example of one of those disease management zones that we have established in Grundy County. After we had that first detection just north of Wellsburg in Grundy County. And so this just gives you an idea of the size of those disease management zones. And so it's within one of these zones where we would implement that increased surveillance for 3 to 5 years. If we get additional detections, then we might transition into more of a prevalence monitoring. We might consider additional harvest opportunity. But in this zone in particular, in Grundy County, we're still in that initial increased sampling mode. So again, I'll put this map up here again. If you are on the joining us tonight and are hunting in one of these areas where we have this increased sampling effort in these darker areas that you see here on the map, strongly encourage you, if you're willing to help with our surveillance program, to contact your local wildlife biologist to submit tissue samples from deer that you harvest in the upcoming deer seasons. So now let's transition a bit into talking about what we all can do to help slow the spread of this disease. And when I say what can we all do, it's not just the DNR, it's not just hunters, it includes everyone in Iowa: wildlife watchers, captive deer and elk producers, taxidermists, wildlife rehabilitators, obviously agencies like the DNR, the Department of Agriculture, county conservation boards. Everyone can do something to help slow the spread of this disease, and it really is an all hands on deck effort. First, I think what's perhaps most important is to become informed about chronic wasting disease. Do exactly what you're doing tonight. Attend public meetings, do some research online, learn what you can about chronic wasting disease, where it is in Iowa, and what you can do to help slow the spread of the disease. One of the best places to get information on chronic wasting disease is our Department of Natural Resources Deer Health webpage. You can scan the QR code there on the left side of your screen. That will take you to our Deer Health webpage, which provides a wealth of information about not only chronic wasting disease, but also about hemorrhagic disease and a number of other diseases that affect white-tailed deer. You can also learn more about our surveillance program on that webpage as well. One other thing that's on our website that is a new tool that was developed here in the last couple of years is our interactive chronic wasting disease dashboard. And this is a tool that allows you to track our surveillance efforts in near real time throughout the year and across years. And so I highly encourage you to visit our website and check out this really neat tool. It has a number of tabs across the top, as you can see on the screen. The first tab is the one that you're seeing here. It simply provides kind of a high level summary of our surveillance, the total number of deer that have tested positive for chronic wasting disease, how that breaks down by year, the total number of counties within which chronic wasting disease has been detected, and then also shows all of those detections on the map that you see on the right. The next tab that you see there, the 2023-2024 season surveillance, will display the map of our surveillance targets, that map that I showed you earlier with the different shadings. That tab will show that map and will also show our progress towards the different surveillance quotas in different areas of the state. And that becomes really important if you are interested in monitoring our progress and interested in helping with our surveillance program. You can look at that map, zoom into the area of the state that you hunt, and see if we're still needing samples from that area. The third tab, the CWD positive sample statistics, that gives you a breakdown of specifically the positive animals that we've detected. So you can go to that tab and see how many females have detected positive for chronic wasting disease or how many males, and how the positive detections break down by age class. And then the last tab that you see there summarizes our surveillance from 2002 to last year, 2022. And so if you're interested in knowing, for example, how many samples total we've collected in the county that you live or hunt, you can go to that tab, click on your county, and it will tell you how many samples that we've collected in that county since 2002. So this is a really neat tool and hopefully provides you with some more information about our surveillance program and also our efforts throughout the year. One other thing that we encourage folks to do to slow the spread of chronic wasting disease is refrain from supplemental feeding. Again, just to remind you, chronic wasting disease is spread via direct contact, but can also be spread indirectly through contact with contaminated surfaces in the environment. And so when you think about what supplemental feeding does, it encourages unnatural congregation crowding and stress. And we know that that is going to increase the risk for disease transmission. And so we strongly encourage folks to consider refraining from doing that throughout the year in order to slow the spread of chronic wasting disease. And this is especially important in areas where we've previously detected the disease. Another thing that we recommend is proper carcass disposal and also trying to minimize carcass movement as much as possible, especially if you hunt in an area where chronic wasting disease has been previously detected. What you see here is a map of locations from which successful deer hunters traveled to three of our chronic wasting disease endemic areas in Alma Key, Clayton, and Wayne County. And so that you can see by this map that we had hunters from almost every county in Iowa travel to one of these three areas to successfully harvest a white-tailed deer. This was in 2021. And this is something that we see year after year. So when you think about transporting potentially infected carcasses out of these areas, that proper carcass disposal and minimizing transport becomes really important. What does proper carcass disposal look like? We recommend that you, if you have to transport a carcass away from the harvest site to process it, say, or to take it to the locker, we recommend trying to get that carcass into an ultimate waste stream, whether that be a landfill or say a municipal trash service. If you're taking the carcass to a locker, oftentimes they have some sort of incineration or rendering service that's going to pick up that carcass. Ultimately, that carcass is not going to go back out onto the landscape, and that's what's most important. However, we do recognize that that option may not always be available to everyone. And so if there's nothing else available, we recommend simply leaving the carcass at the harvest site or taking it back to the harvest site after processing. We know that that's not removing the potentially infected carcass from the landscape, but what we do know also is that that is not moving the carcass to a new site and potentially infecting a new area. We encourage citizens, hunters, anyone that's out and about in Iowa to report sick deer or road kills to local DNR staff. This is, again, especially important in areas where we've detected chronic wasting disease in the past, because we will sample those road kills and add them to our surveillance program. And obviously, if you do hunt or live in an area where chronic wasting disease has been detected and you observe a deer that is acting abnormally or looks sick, we want to know about that so that we can gather more information and determine the best course of action for that deer. Now, I will remind everyone, as I mentioned before, that not every sick deer is infected with chronic wasting disease. And it's really hard for us to know with certainty whether or not a deer is infected with chronic wasting disease by simply looking at the signs of that deer on the hoof. And so the best thing is to report it to us. We'll gather more information and determine the best course of action. I mentioned the importance of testing, and I will mention it again here. Testing your deer for chronic wasting disease, again, especially if you're hunting in areas where we've previously detected the disease, is very important, not only for you as a hunter in order to make informed consumption decisions, but also we really appreciate those samples for our surveillance program because it does provide us the best information that we can get in monitoring this disease. What does testing look like? We remove what are called the medial retropharyngeal lymph nodes from the deer. So essentially, those are the lymph nodes that you might feel swell up when you're not feeling well. The lymph nodes just right under your jaw right here. So all of testing involves is just a simple cut right below the jaw. We'll remove those lymph nodes from the animal and submit those for testing. We also collect a variety of other information, including the age and sex of the deer. We want to have that information because it helps contribute to our surveillance program. We collect the location of harvest, and then we also collect the registration number on your deer tag. And that registration number is really important because it provides you the opportunity to query your sample results online after the sample was submitted. So you can actually go onto our website, onto that Iowa DNR Deer Health page, and you can look up the results of your sample after it was submitted. Typically, we try to return samples within about 2 weeks. Now, that may vary depending on when the sample was submitted throughout the year. Sometimes samples submitted in earlier hunting seasons, say in early archery season or in early muzzleloader season, might take a little bit longer because we're not getting the volume of samples coming in during that time. During the shotgun seasons, where we're getting a lot of samples coming in, it might take 1 to 2 weeks. So we tell folks about 2 weeks on average. Another opportunity that's available to hunters is what we call our hunter submission pathway. And this is a partnership with the Iowa State University Veterinary Diagnostic Lab. And this is an opportunity for hunters to submit samples of deer that might not meet our surveillance criteria. So for example, we do not include any fawns in our surveillance program, but we recognize that hunters that harvest fawns might be interested in testing that animal in order to make informed consumption decisions. We also know that as the hunting seasons pass, we are filling our sampling quotas in different areas of the state. And so again, If you're hunting in that area, our sampling quota has already been filled for our surveillance program, but you might still want to get that deer, harvested deer, tested. This is an opportunity for you to do that through this partnership with Iowa State University. It's a really simple process. You go to our website, the link there that's listed at the bottom. You fill out a simple web submission form. You can contact our local staff. They will help you pull the sample if you prefer. We also have a video on our Iowa DNR Deer Health page that will walk you through how to pull the sample if you're interested in doing it yourself. There is a cost associated with this sample. It is $25 per sample. That's the same price that that we pay for samples that are submitted through our surveillance program. And so it's a really nice partnership with the university to provide this additional option for hunters to get their animals tested. I mentioned before that you're able to query your sample results online. And this is our Iowa DNR Deer Health page, or our surveillance and results page. You'll notice a couple of buttons there in the center of the screen. The red button is the button that you would click if you were interested in querying the results of a sample that you submitted. The green button on the right is the button that you would click if you were interested in submitting a sample through that hunter submission pathway that I just described. And the last thing that you can do to help slow the spread of chronic wasting disease, especially if you're a hunter joining us tonight, is to keep hunting. We know that hunting is the number one way in which we can effectively manage white-tailed deer populations in Iowa, and therefore is the number one way in which we can help slow the spread of this disease. We also know that it's a really important tradition and recreational opportunity that's available to Iowa citizens. And so we encourage you to keep taking advantage of that opportunity and continue to share that that joy and that tradition with your family and friends. That concludes our presentation for this evening. We'll now take a few minutes here to answer any questions that have come in during the Q&A. But I do also want to mention that if you have any questions after tonight that either don't get answered, or if something comes to mind after our presentation tonight, you're welcome to contact either myself or our state wildlife veterinarian, Dr. Rachel Rudin. Our phone numbers and email addresses are listed there on the screen. Please feel free to contact us with any questions that you might have after this evening. I really appreciate you all attending tonight. Hopefully we were able to answer some questions that you might have and to help you understand a little bit more about chronic wasting disease and what we do to monitor for and manage this disease. So again, we'll take a few minutes now. I'll open up the Q&A box and see if there are any questions that have come in that have not already been answered. So I noticed there's one question in the Q&A box. Someone asked, how do you locate your local DNR biologist or DNR staff? That's a really great question. We did have one of our staff post a link in the chat box. If you open up the webinar chat box at the bottom of your screen, there will be a link there that has contact information for our DNR biologists across the state. So you'll be able to look at that map, see where you live or the county in which you hunt, and be able to find the local DNR biologists for that area. Again, if you have any questions, please feel free to type them into the Q&A box. We're happy to answer any questions that you have. We'll take another few minutes here to allow folks to gather some thoughts and type in some questions. And if there are no additional questions, we'll conclude for the evening. Okay, I see a couple of really great questions that have come into the Q&A. The first of which is, how many deer have tested positive for chronic wasting disease in Winnesheet County through 2022? David, that's a very good question. And unfortunately, that's a number that I do not have off the top of my head. If of any of my colleagues from the DNR are on the meeting tonight and have that information, please feel free to jump on. It looks like our state wildlife veterinarian may be responding to your question there in the box, David.
Yeah, I'll just respond live. It looks like three from 2022, but that was not the first year that we had positive deer detected. I could get that total number. I'll get back to you on that.
Yeah, thanks, Rachel. Okay, Robert asked, if I get my deer processed at a locker, what do I do until the results come back from that sample? Great question, Robert. So it really depends on various lockers have different processes. I will say that. Some lockers, if you do get the deer tested, will hold your deer until the results come back, and then they'll proceed with processing that animal. One thing that you could also consider, and it depends on how you process the animal, but we do also recommend that if folks are taking meat to a locker, if you say wanted to bone that animal out or quarter it out and store it in a freezer at home until the results come back and then take it to the locker. So essentially you're holding that deer yourself rather than having the locker do it. That's also an option that that you could consider. Okay, I see another question in the box here. Will a doe that is infected with CWD have a positive fawn? That's a great question. The answer to that is very likely yes. We know that because chronic wasting disease is spread via direct contact, even if that vertical transmission, meaning the fawn becoming infected in utero, does not happen, we do know that as soon as that fawn is born, that doe is obviously going to be grooming that fawn by licking it and coming in frequent contact with it. So if that doe is infected with chronic wasting disease, it's very likely that the fawn will also become infected. Okay, I'm just scrolling down through the questions here. I see a couple of the questions that have been asked. Some of our staff are responding to in the chat or in the box there, so I'll let them do that. Mike, your question about finding six dead deer next to water last week, what's going on? Another great question. So I mentioned before, we are experiencing a pretty significant outbreak of hemorrhagic disease in Iowa this year. And oftentimes, deer that succumb to the effects of hemorrhagic disease do so near water because it causes them to be feverish and essentially the hemorrhaging causes them to be attracted to and needing to drink water. And so it's likely that those deer succumb to hemorrhagic disease.
Tyler, there's a question about lymph nodes and are they fragile and what do we do with them? So to answer that, they're not fragile at all. They hold up very well, even in pretty decomposed carcasses, but of course they're going to be a lot easier to find in a fresh animal and especially before the animal may get a little bit frozen. So you could really feel the difference in the density of the tissues compared to some of the surrounding salivary gland, for instance. But freezing is actually perfect. That's what we would recommend for sending them to the lab. And yeah, that won't compromise them at all.
Thank you, Rachel. Looks like that is all of the questions that we have in the box. Any other quick questions? Otherwise, we will conclude for the evening. Okay, well, again, thank you everyone for attending this evening. This is one of the most important things that you can do in helping slow the spread of this disease is arming yourself with the best information possible. And so we really appreciate you taking the time to join us tonight to learn a little bit more about this disease affecting our deer population in Iowa. Again, if you have any questions after tonight, please feel free to contact either Dr. Rudin or myself. Thanks very much for attending, and we'll conclude for this evening.